Well, I taught Sunday school, you know. Oh, I have a story to tell you about Sunday school. And I was telling this the other day because I was talking in the library. We had a little boy that was in our Sunday school class who was 30 years old when he was born. You know, he was one of these, 6 years old. Brian was his name. And Mrs. Harris is the flannel characters of Noah's Ark. Right? Brian is not buying it. He just is not to be bad. And she said, Brian, they need each other. Come on, the food, you know, where do you get the food? Where do you get the water? So on and so forth. And down the middle of it was little Otto, who was in my carpool with my kids, and never talked, and he finally raised his hand like this. He said, I know how they did it, Mrs. Harris. And all three of us teachers gulped, you know, said, how did they do it, Otto? They took in baby animals. And Brian dropped the front, he says, that'll do it. And now when I see pictures of, you know, the giraffe's head, mm-hmm. I think, nope. They took in baby animals.
Yeah, to see if your lines were ready.
Oh, lights in it.
I have a picture that goes in the
side. Okay, you ready? And you ready?
What are we doing?
Switch to attack.
Sound bite.
All right, ready? Go.
Captain Hook here for Combat Radio. Back here with Margaret Kerry and Bob Kerr, Disney legends. We're glad to have them. We're going to hear some wonderful stories. Okay, we'll also have to listen to Ethan too, but we'll put up with that. All right, there you go.
One more.
Just again, same thing.
Just roll it. Your insult wasn't loud enough.
All right, I didn't insult Ethan loud enough. Everyone didn't hear it. He's a great man, though. Does a lot of good work. Welcome to Combat Radio. We're here with Margaret Kerry, Bob Gurr, Disney legends. I tell you, they have some great stories, and if you're a Disney freak like I am, you'll love it. I am a Disney freak, though.
Captain Hook came out of character at the end of that. Do you want to...
What a blessing that this man is. I mean, I go to Disneyland or to the shops or people who come to the shows that we do, and I'm thinking, I know that he would be so thrilled to know that he's keeping 300,000 artists working. I mean, where else would they do this? And I know that that would just excite him no end, as long as the work is good, of course, but and it usually is. And the idea of, I don't know, I have this feeling of that he oversees things and is smiling because he did it when he walked one of my dearest friends is Steve Zoll, and Steve Zoll's father's company did the lighting for Disneyland. And he would tell the stories that he would stay with Walt Disney until 9 or 10 o'clock at night, walking Disneyland and trying this chandelier or this lighting or how this went. He said, I have never met a man, said Mr. Zoll, I have never met a man so focused on what he's doing, and he's so always right. So I just, a genius.
Well, there was another characteristic that was very funny. Sometimes I'd be a bit absent-minded trying to keep track of everything I'm doing. And when I'm driving in the car between, let's say, Maple and the studio, and I want to remember something, I'd write a series of notes and I'd paste it on my speedometer because I knew wherever I would look, I would eventually look at that speedometer to see how fast I'm going. And I did that for years. And one day I pulled up and I parked at the lot next to his car and I looked over. He's got piles of notes pasted all over the speedometer. And I thought, that man never stops.
Jimmy, I want to give you a chance to weigh in here. I know you did.
And you have some project for your child to do. And the child, you're waiting and you're hoping and you're looking. And then the child doesn't come up to your standards of what you want. The irritation that goes on. Walt Disney, I do believe everything that I have heard and read about him, he had these ideas of how it should look, and he kept waiting for people to come through. Now, Bob Gurr came through, but there were other people who didn't come right up to what his expectation. So there is this irritation of waiting for it to be perfect. And I know as a dance director, that happens when your dancers don't come right up to what you want it to do, and you can only wait for them to do it because you can't do it for them. It's an irritation that people don't understand if you're looking for that. So that's what I've always felt with him, with that intensity that you're talking about. And then I think, you know, I don't think I ever saw him smile. His eyes were smiling, and he was chatting, but I never saw him on a broad smile. And I thought, he's just too busy.
Bob, the best compliment Walt ever gave you was what?
I don't really remember that he gave people compliments in the ordinary sense of a compliment.
Right.
He'd do a thing like this. Let's say you got an office next to Jim here. He'd go into your office and he'd look at something, see what you're doing, wouldn't say anything, and then he'd walk out and he'd go down to Jim's office and he says, "Say, you ought to go, you know, what Ethan's doing, you ought to go take a look at that." And then, of course, the minute he's out of sight, you run down to Ethan and says, "Walt was just here, show me the thing that he liked." Well, that's the compliment, was always the transfer comment. But in my case, I guess the one would have been different. Remember, Walt had us all work on everything all at once. In the case of the monorail, yes, I was doing the outside styling of it. Then I was doing all the engineering of it, making the lion's share of the drawings. And then Walt asked me, supervising the manufacture in the studio lot. We had an outside factory, and they got behind schedule. So we moved the whole monorail project into a sound stage, the one where the 20,000 Leagues pit was, where they had the squid fight. And so many people were watching to see what we were doing every day. I put a rope in front of the soundstage door to keep everybody out. Now I'm just too doggone busy in there. And every day Walt would come walking by, usually with somebody with him. And then one day he stops, and Mickey Clark, finance guy, calls me over, hands me a white envelope, and they walk away. And I open the envelope, and there's $1,000 cash. And the only comment was from Mickey Clark was, "Walt can't figure out how you're doing this."
Oh.
Well, Walt collected people that would do stuff, and we were all doing stuff.
You didn't say for like another $1,000, I'll tell him.
No, I thought, well, my, isn't that is different. And I took that. One of the most important things, I think, that really kind of stopped me in my tracks.
Margaret?
I just want to mention, Jim has talked about his book in 200 pages, and he brought all of the things that we've been talking about from you know, way back. I was 1951, you were before that with what you were during that time, up to now. How did you get 200 pages? You can cut all of that down and put it. I can hardly wait to read it. What's the name of the book?
It's a book about Disney, so it's called The Disney Book.
It's a good title. That's a good title for it. Yeah.
But I'm sitting here because all of the things that I'm hearing, I mean, we've talked 800 pages already just talking to what's going on here. Congratulations.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
It's definitely an overview. There's not a lot of depth to it. But it's the photos, it's the artwork, as always with Disney, it's about the visuals.
And I think there's a double page in there about Peter Pan.
Yeah.
Your Peter Pan is well represented, Margaret.
Well, I should hope so.
It's The Disney Book, a celebration of the world of Disney by Jim Fanning, author and historian. Margaret Kerry, your book will be available around the time of your birthday, Tinkerbell Talks.
Yes.
And hopefully we'll be back to do another broadcast at that book's release. And then for legend Bob Gurr, the book is called Fail Fast, Combat Radio Conversations with Disney legend Bob Gurr. I'm Ethan for Combat Radio, Barnes & Noble here in Burbank. The legends will be here for a little while longer, and we'll be right back.
And all the other amazing, amazing things you've done as ambassador for Disney all these years. And we're looking forward to the release of your wonderful book that's been 13 years in the making.
Yes, yes.
And course, look forward to spending many more happy times here with you, and we thank you most sincerely for being here today.
And thank you for Barnes & Noble. It's my home away from home. Yes, people walk up to me. I made a mistake when I started writing my book. I shouldn't have told anybody. Really, if you go to write a book, don't tell anybody, because they still come walking up to me and say, oh, I can hardly wait to read your book. And then I look at them and say, neither can I. But it will be out this year on my birthday, I hope, May 11th. Mother's Day, which is most appropriate. And I am Margaret Kerry. I was originally Margaret Lorraine McCarty. Then I got adopted. My mother passed away when I was 3 and a half, and I became Peggy Lorraine Robb. I went to work in the movies when I was 4 years old, and I thought you might like to see this.
Oh my God. Mm-hmm.
In our gay comedies, that's me right there.
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh.
And I have been working 83 years at it and having a lovely time. So I thought I'd bring that out and show you like that. So I learned to tap dance when I was 4. I caused the Depression, you see. You laugh, but I was born in 1929 and everything went right downhill from there, believe me. So when I was adopted, my parents, who were old enough to be my grandparents, thought nothing of it, put her to work. I could make $8.50 a day. That was pretty good stuff. And I was cute, and I could tap dance. I couldn't sing worth a darn, but that didn't seem to bother anybody. And I worked in 37 major motion pictures and on the stage. And I was usually the blur that went by, you know, or the one, somebody had one line. But it was great. It was very different. It was strange. And so, but a thing came in to my life, and it was called W6XYZ, experimental television. And I thought, that is the greatest thing. You do not know what it is to be a child actor. You go into a sound stage, which is so cold anyway, and it's dark, and it smells of cement, and they put you in a 12 by 12 room with a teacher, with adult chairs that don't fit you at all, and you're trying to do your work, and then you have to talk in a whisper. Did you know that?